Hello guys. So today we are in Brighton. I'm super excited because I've never been here. And the other reason that I'm super excited is I am going to shoot a camera that I have never, ever, ever tried before, but I have heard a lot of it. And it's this. It's a Zenit. This is the Olympics Games edition. And it looks super nice. It was really hard to find. I mean, it's not a super hard to find camera, but I wanted this specific model. So I searched through eBay and I found it and I bought it thanks to my Patreons. So this camera will go to one of my Patreons. Yeah, I hope you like it. I think it's super nice. It came with this leather case and it came with another leather thing in the front. I'm gonna show you once I get home, but it looks super cool. And I am going to try a film that I already know, and it's the Kodak Ultramax 400. It's a 400 ISO film, and I quite like this film. It's not an expensive film, but it's, I don't know, I quite like it. I have tried before and I know more or less how it should look. Yeah, that's it guys. I hope you enjoyed this episode and let's see what happens. And so that was the whole experience shooting with the Zenit. Zenit? How do you say it? I say Zenit in Spanish, so I'll just say Zenit. Excuse me if that's not how you pronounce it, but whatever. Zenit. That's the whole experience with the Zenit. I think it's an interesting camera. The results didn't surprise me. I thought it would be like, oh my god, it's so sharp, it's so amazing, but they're actually okay, but I think it's a camera that takes a few rolls to get used to. It's not an immediate camera. It's not like you're gonna start shooting and you're gonna achieve amazing results immediately, but it's a great camera regardless. It looks really nice. It works really well. The shutter is noisy but satisfying. It sounds like a sturdy shutter. So that's okay, that's nice. The lens is cool too. I was surprised because the metering works really well. At the beginning, I wasn't sure if the light meter on the camera was actually working or was accurate. So I was shooting with a handheld light meter, actually with my cell phone, and I was measuring the light with the cell phone and then see if the camera was giving me the right results, and it was consistently giving me the correct light metering. So I ended up just using the light meter on the camera and it works pretty well. It's a pretty basic camera. It's super down to the bone kind of experience. So if you're looking for something that doesn't have many layers between you and your object and you can just grab it and use all your photographic experience to get the shot, this is a pretty cool camera. Shutter speeds, you only have 500, 250, 125, 60, 30 and bulb. That's all the options you have. What I ended up doing most of the time was just have it fixed at 500 and then just controlling the aperture and deciding. The aperture was the way for me to decide how much light would I let in. One thing about controlling the shutter speed that's kind of weird, but it makes sense in what I was saying, is I just left it on 500 and just adjust the aperture, because modifying the shutter speed was a pain in the ass for speed shooting. Like if you want to shoot something that's happening on the street and you want to be quick about it, you can forget about modifying the shutter speed. In this regard, it's super hard, if not basically impossible, to move it with one finger, as you can see. I mean, you can do it, but it's not easy and it's not comfortable and it's not secure. So if you want to modify it, you need to move it like this. And the problem with that is the reading on the camera is only taken once you half press the shutter. So if you want to take the reading of the scene, you half press it and then you modify it and then you half press it and then you, this is the right speed, and then you take the picture. But if you do it with the aperture, it's different. You only set the shutter speed at whatever shutter speed you want to shoot. You see, oh, it's too much light, and then you can close it down or up. Okay, this is perfect. And then you take the picture. So it's much easier, at least in my experience, to use only the aperture on the lens. So if you're looking for a camera to get your way on film, and you don't want to actually spend a lot of money, or you don't want any camera that has some kind of automation to it, this might be a good choice. I don't like I don't like automatic cameras usually. I use extensively the Canon A1, and the Canon A1 is a really great camera, but it has aperture priority or shutter speed priority. So something is gonna be automatic. I mean, you can override it, but the light metering is confusing and it's not really easy to shoot when you override it in manual. But with this camera, I think it's super easy to operate everything manually, because everything is manual. So if you're comfortable with that, or you want to feel more comfortable shooting with only manual cameras and you want to give it a shot, this might be a good option. I thought it was going to be like super brutal, but it's actually pretty okay. One thing though that I think it's kind of important is rewinding the camera and loading it. It's kind of counterintuitive. So that's the reason why I didn't show the video how to load or unload the camera, because I want to show it here. Okay, so to open the camera, you just lift this and that's it. It's super easy. You just load your film as usual and then you just wind it and everything works as normal. But when you finish your roll, when you're done, when everything is said and done and your roll is at the end and you can't wind anymore, that's when you need to rewind the camera. And in order to rewind the camera, what usually happens is that there's a button at the bottom of the camera, or there's some kind of knob that you press and you can start winding. And you can start doing this, which is the normal way in which you wind the camera. But on this one,
There is a button specifically, the shutter speed is the shutter speed, of course, but it's also the winding button. And you need to move it to the left, like almost half a turn. And it's kind of hard to move, but when you do it, then you can start winding the camera. And then you can just do it normally and start winding like what you would usually do. I know it sounds confusing, but I hope the me showing you how it happens, it's easier than just trying to explain it. Apart from that, I think it's a really nice camera. There were some people in the comment section saying that this camera, they had this same camera or some other seen it, and they usually broke their films. That's what happened with mine. I just broke the film when I tried to unload it. So I don't know if it's a thing that happens with all Cinets. If you're a Cinet user, you can maybe like give some insights. But on my experience, it destroyed, not destroyed, it cut my film right on the end on frame 30. It cut my frame on 20, with the 22nd frame. So it's not that bad. I lost 3 shots. I don't know what your experience is. If you have any experience with this camera and you have lost frames or have any way of avoiding getting your film cut, you might send a few insights. So yeah, that's it. I hope you enjoyed the episode. Thanks a lot to my Patreons who allow me to have this camera, and I'm gonna send it to one of them. I already did the raffle and we all know who this is going for. So it's gonna have a new owner now. I hope you enjoy this camera and you can post some shots once you start using it. And before I go, like, thanks a lot. We just reached 20,000 subscribers. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people, and I just wanted to say thank you. Thanks a lot for everything, and yeah, I'll see what I can do. That's the problem. I always say I'm gonna do something when I reach some milestone, but then I just get there and I just never do it because I just keep posting videos. But I hope I'll come up with something creative to give you guys a big thank you. And that's it. I'll see you next week. And keep shooting, guys.